everybody. I am Pork Cunningham. I don't know where my honorable distinguished co-host Frank Oliva Beans is today. I guess he's probably drowning in a big vat of pork and beans. But in any event, he's not here. So we're just going to go solo today, which actually is probably a good thing. Okay. Got complete control now. We don't need Mr. Beans today. So, hey, my guest today is Dawn Nicholson, and she is the ambassador for the Sacred Spiral of Purity and Light Council. And that's pretty interesting. So why don't you tell us how you became aware that you were the ambassador, or give us the backstory on it?
Sure. Hello, everybody. I'm glad you get to edit here. So, okay. maybe it's good for me to ask you questions since you're going to be editing. I don't really want to focus on the attack part because I don't want people to focus on the bad part. So I have that kind of that block in my mind there. So what would you suggest? Just chat away. And if you're my coach, your beautiful show,
just talk about the council, whatever. You don't have to talk about the,
I won't talk about the details of it, but okay. So thank you. I'm very happy to be here on your show. When I became aware of the Sacred Spiral of Purity and Light High Council, it was through telepathic communications. Originally, I had in 2016, April and May of 2016, and several months later, I was attacked in different ways by beings that I thought were demonic beings, and then I was saved by angels. Well, the council would be those angels and those beings of light that actually saved me and then began teaching me. They told me that this was my destiny, is how the council explained it to me. And they reminded me of different things that had happened in my life that were actually like little markers there that I could go back and look at and see that I was being prepared from the time that I was little. And so when I was in elementary school, one of the first things and one of the strongest memories that I have is that I was traveling with my mother. We were in Jackpot, Nevada. We had breakfast, and she was going to pay the bill, and I went to the gift shop because I collected postcards. And I was looking at these photographs and pictures of Jesus. And then next thing I know, I was there with him. And he gave me a message that I never forgot. I can still remember it as if it just took place. And so I've learned since then that he probably pulled me out of body and so took me to a place. Since I was a little girl, he knelt down, and he was dressed very similar to like that painting where he's in the garden with the children. And he told me that life was going to be very difficult, but I should not forget that he was always there with me, that he loved me, and that later on in life, he had a very important job for me to do. And so throughout my whole life, I've tried to figure out, well, what is that job? Because I knew that that experience was real. And so to finish that experience, what happened is when my mother came in to get me in the gift shop, she had to shake me to, bring my awareness to her, and not hard, but just, you know, hey, what's going on here? And the woman said, she just froze. She just froze looking at the pictures there. And for me, I was super excited because when my awareness came back, I was like, oh my gosh, Mom, Jesus was talking to me, da-da-da-da-da, you know, and I was just chattering away and really excited. But this is that job that he was talking about, is the ambassador to the sacred spiral of purity and light. So I'm here as a human in a human body, but my soul is a different being. I come from the Fae, and so...
That's fairies?
Go ahead.
Is that a word for fairies?
Yes, the Fae. But I would be on the elven side of the Fae, and so I've been told by a very good friend of mine that the elven people are the angels of the Fae, and so I believe that, because when I've seen them, they're beautiful. And so just pure light, lots of blues and violets, different colors running through them, but they're very beautiful. And so that's who I am. So I own it. I believe it because of just the experiences in my life. I've been very close to nature, very much an outdoors person. I'm happy camping, fishing, just enjoying everything. And I have always marveled at just the beauty of like a flower or a bumblebee or anything like that. So I've always had that very close connection to nature. And so when the attacks had started and I didn't understand what was going on, I reverted back to whatever my conditioning and programming was growing up. And so that was a Christian background. And so as the attacks stopped and the light beings were able, and they were like healing me, like on the spot healing. There were times actually when I was bruised, when I was bleeding, when I knew I had internal injuries. And so there was a lot of crazy stuff that happened. And I wasn't...
Through the attack, you mean? You had this?
Yeah, through the different attacks that happened. And so it takes a lot for me to have gotten over that. It took a lot of time with the council working with me, talking to me, explaining things to me. And what they did to prepare me for this role to speak and talk about them is, not only did they tell me about them and how they're put together, but they also took me through personal shadow work that you would do and going within. And they would even take me back to like the first memory when I was a toddler, when I became terrified of my father, because he was a very abusive, mean drunk. So that home life was not beautiful. It was very traumatic. And so so they've taken me back to those times where I can watch myself as the toddler and see myself hiding behind my mother and stuff. And so what that does is that allows us a better understanding of who we are, what makes us who we are, how we communicate with people, why do we behave a certain way. Well, so much comes from just everything that we experience that comes around us. It's you know, if your first experience working is dealing with a really nasty boss, you're not going to have really warm, fuzzy feelings for later on in life. And so and working. And so they've shared a lot of that with me. They've taken me through personal experiences. The first thing that they wanted me to do was to go to Columbus, Ohio. Well, actually, the very first conference I went to was to go watch Corey Good speak. And it was in 2016, August of 2016. They had me go there, and it was Rob Potter's conference there on Mount Shasta. And so it was Rob, it was Corey Good, it was Laura Eisenhower, and Michael Sala. And so it was an amazing lineup, basically. And the news and the information that came from them was just like hitting me with overload. I was like, secret space programs, alien beings. I just, all of it was just like, wow. Because I always believed in other life. You know, I think we're ignorant if we think we're the only living things on this planet, and this is the only planet where there's life. And so listening to them speak, it was like, okay, all right. So I had to, the council sent me to meet different people. So there they didn't send me to actually meet any of the speakers. It was there to listen. But the first conference that they sent me to was in Columbus, Ohio, and they wanted me to specifically meet Michael Lee Hill. And so that's what I did, is I went there and I met Michael and I met his friends, and instantly it was like being with family. And so each conference that they sent me to, they had specific people that they had me meet, listen to what they were speaking about, so that I would, I guess, be more well-rounded, because there's not just Arcturians, as you know, there's not just Pleiadians, it's everybody. And there's the Sasquatch, there's the Fae beings, there's all these different races, and I don't even know the names of every group that's on the High Council, but there's even these water beings that are just like, if you think of a sheet of water, is how I've seen them. They're really beautiful, but that it's like having all these new experiences, seeing these different beings. And a lot of them I see with the third eye or your inner eye. I've seen flashes. I've always dreamt or had prophetic dreams and sometimes prophetic visions. And so that part of my abilities just like exploded. And so now I understand, you know, some of it's remote viewing and you're looking at things, but I still don't fully control all of that. But I see the future. I see many different things, and the council helps to kind of control where I'm going so that I get to, so I can then describe it back to people. This is the future that the council has in store for the planet. And so it's very beautiful. A lot of the stuff is very beautiful, but it took me a good, I'd say 2.5 to 3 years before I felt really solid and comfortable in my role, in my knowledge base, so that I could then talk to everybody and just share information, answer questions. And so now this is kind of like my official kickoff in many ways. And I was looking forward to having the whole, you know, group and the big show and everything so that we could really, you know, get into questions and stuff.
Well, that's going to happen.
Good.
I feel energy and whatever.
Yeah.
And I know when I'm talking, oh boy.
Yeah.
Awesome. I know when
I'm talking. I know, me too. It's like, yes.
Like, I know when I'm talking to somebody who's talking the truth. That's something important to say. So rest assured, we're not going to sell you short. Hopefully, they won't play around too much with this video I'm going to put out. So we'll put the video out first. This will kind of just be an introduction.
Okay, awesome.
Once I figure the technical difficulties out and whatever, we're going to have, we will do an entire...
Yes.
And do it justice. You know, where we'll have it on a bunch of groups and stuff.
Right.
Like that,
so. What would be great is if the introduction video is like the invitation to the live one, and then people come with their questions.
Because
for instance, somebody who's listening is very close to gnomes, and I'm just picking gnomes for the heck of it.
Right.
They might have questions specifically about, are the gnomes involved, or what is their role, or have you seen them? I'm open to all questions. I really am, because I've had so many fascinating experiences since I've been trained since 2016. And it's exciting. I think it's beautiful. I think the future that they have in store for the planet is absolutely beautiful. I will not talk about like the 5D thing, because they really didn't educate me in that. So I'm not knowledgeable about that. So people can see similarities there where the earth is going to change, vibration changes, beauty comes back, everything heals. But I'm not, like we talked earlier, I'm not I don't follow other people and what they talk about, because there's so much that happened with me that I listen specifically to the counsel. And then if I'm talking to someone and they share information with me that's new, the counsel will ask me, well, how do you feel about that? Because they're with me 24/7. And so they talk to me every single day telepathically. Mm-hmm. And so if I hear something that's new and I'm like, well, it doesn't sound like it's 100% correct, then they will say, very good, you know, it's not. Or, nah, you need to just kind of listen a little bit more. So they guide me even in those ways. And so everybody has something here. Everybody has a piece of the puzzle. You have a piece of the puzzle. We've all been given what I would call little nuggets of information, of the truth. And a lot of times that might get buried in other stuff, our life and how we're living and everything, but we have that truth and that's our core. And so I try to pull myself back to that truth that I feel and stuff, because I hear so much. And even with the news and everything, you know, what's going on here? Is this a Q thing or this or that? I just don't follow any of that as like closely, and I believe it word for word. I hear it and let it process through me. And
yeah, well, I found, you know, that when I've had some of my downloads or whatever, and when I've been in that fifth dimension of energy and no judgment and love or whatever, it was like I had an all-knowing, but I didn't have all the details going around in my head. The details weren't important. Mm-hmm. It was, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
And also I agree with you, because, you know, like since I started being taught by my Sasquatch teachers, I can't really afford to be reading other people's books or opinions so much. I mean, I do talk on people online, and you see a lot of collaborative evidence where, you know, like that happened to me, and it enhances and strengthens everybody. But, you know, I have to rely on what my teachers are telling me. Mm-hmm. And so I don't really veer off and so much. And that's what you were kind of saying, right?
Right. And because of this council is also overseeing the war effort with the dark beings and ridding the dark beings from the planet, they told me up front, you know, we're going to lie to you about some stuff. We're going to throw some dates out there. We're going to throw some stuff here and there. But that's to keep you safe, because if a being was to get into my mind, like what happened in the beginning with the attacks, mm-hmm. and read my mind, if I held true actual war details or battle details or location details, then they would grab me. The other side would grab me to get all that information because of the war. And I believe that. And I believe that the council doesn't do anything intentionally to harm people at all. But I tell people up front now, don't ask me for dates. Don't ask me to tell you, you know, specific things that would potentially put a war effort at risk. And so that's...
Yeah, and I mean, some of these dates, I mean, we're all, like, we create our reality. Mm-hmm. So these dates can change by according to what we create leading right. up to those dates. So dates are kind of like, I've never put any faith in them anyway.
You know, right.
They're kind of just useless information for me. Anyway, I think.
And that's a good way to think about it. I mean, the council, they have channeled through me with a smaller group that I'm friends with. And they have said that the main part of the war effort will be finished by the end of this year. And so that kind of coincides with some of the ascension details and stuff, but I don't know enough of the specifics about the ascension process and timelines. I just know that when I watched Hale's movie for his new documentary coming out, that basically they're looking at December 21st of this year for the big event to happen. I don't know. And so the council hasn't told me, yes, the big event's going to happen. what they've told me is they have something planned, but it doesn't, it's not the same as what I've heard described with the big giant solar flare or something that wipes out life on the planet. That what the council has told me is the event that they have planned has to do with light, color, and sound, vibration, and that it will essentially change everything on the planet. Now, that's what they've told me. And, you know, some people will say, well, yeah, that feeds right into the ascension thing. But I'm not going to go there and say, absolutely, I agree with you, because the council hasn't told me that. So I'm not going to go there, even though me personally, I'm wondering and I'm thinking about, you know, what is this event going to be and how will it affect everybody? I do know that the council has shared with me that there would be a lot of death on the planet, and that death has to do with what the Cabal Illuminati groups have already placed in the process, and that includes people who have passed from cancer or other things that they have created. Mm-hmm. And so I'm a big girl. I can handle that. It's war. I understand that there's death, but there's a lot of people that have taken a very negative reaction to that. They don't want to hear that. They want everything to be warm and fuzzy. And I'm a very practical person. And you know, you can't just go la 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 la. This stuff isn't going on. It's going on, and we're here to fix it. And so we're taking action to fix it. We're being proactive. We're a part of the solution. We're not a part of the problem. And that's how I see people like you, like myself, like Barbara and stuff. We're a part of the solution. We're not a part of the problem.
Well, I was going to hope you were going to say we're part of the problem.
No, not at all. No. And it's like, okay, so I know this is probably not going to flow like super easy, but you get to edit it. So how I first came in contact with the Sasquatch was June of 2016. I was down in southeastern Oregon. I was at a place called Dead Horse Lake, which is like a high mountain alpine lake. There was still snow while we were driving up there and stuff in areas.
Dead Horse Lake?
Yeah, my guess is somebody's horse died in the lake and they named it after that. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it could be, but I guess so, yeah.
But my friends are avid fishermen, fisherwomen, boaters and everything. And this little lake is kind of, you can take a kayak on and stuff and fish and enjoy yourself. And so I was walking to go to the camp post to get some firewood, and the council alerted me that there was a male and female Sasquatch that were watching. And so the female appeared like energetic wise to be closer to me, and she said, "Who are you and what are you?" And I think she was trying to look into like the physical body to see what type of being I was.
Oh, no, they can read you for sure. Yeah, yeah. I've actually had them go right inside of me. So
yes,
they can really read you. They can read your energy, your intentions, your thoughts.
Everything,
and they probably saw something about you that was very high and enlightened and whatever, and they were interested.
Right, yeah. And I think they also saw the guardians that were walking with me, that were doing the healing or whatever on me. And so... And of course, she spoke telepathically to me. She didn't speak out loud. I didn't physically see her, but I sensed her. And I guess in a sense, in my mind, I have like an energetic image of her. And so...
Did you feel her energy?
I felt the male's energy. And so when I walked up to the camp host and asked him about the firewood and stuff, I started to walk back to the campsite because he was going to deliver it. And I stopped and I was kind of at a higher level looking over the lake and just enjoying the view. And I felt the male, like this, of course, he was really tall, stand like right behind me. And it was as if he was basically looking through everything through me, and also started to help heal some of the wounds and stuff. And so that was my first experience with them. Well, that clan, I don't have the name of the clan, but what they told me is that their clan is a very private clan, kind of sticks to itself. And their clan specifically is hunted in by the dark beings. And I think because of, and so this is my theory here, I think they are hunted because of their healing abilities, their magic abilities. There's something about that clan that is different.
Well, can I step in and make a observation? I think maybe, you know, because the clans that are the teachers who are connecting with us or whatever, obviously the forces that, you know, the dark forces or whoever they are, that is definitely not in their best interest for us to be woken up and to realize our true nature and who we really are, which is what the Sasquatch, the one teaching whatever, are trying to introduce us to. So, yeah, I mean, that's 100% makes sense.
Absolutely. And to me, they're some of the most beautiful beings that I've come into contact with.
Oh.
I love the children. I love the adults, the older seniors of the groups. And how the council asks them to introduce themselves when they speak to me is to show an image of their face. So I will get an image of a Sasquatch face within my mind before the communication starts. And if it's a group that's there, then I don't get like individual images. I get the feeling of, like, if you think of, oh, there's little ones, there's some teenagers, there's some older, you know, established ones. And so I'll get this idea of who's around. And so that clan, what they did for me probably about 3 or 4 weeks later, because they obviously went through my memories, they saw what I saw, they saw what attacked me and everything. And I went to Mount Hood to go walk up to an area where I used to pick huckleberries and there's a small stream that comes down a fairly steep hill, so you have just some really beautiful water noise and stuff. And I used to pick wild mushrooms in that area too. And so I needed to get away, and I drove up there. The road was completely washed out, and it used to be a paved Forest Service road. So it was like a kind of a huge ravine, like 3 or 4 feet wide and quite deep. So I had to get out of the car and walk the rest of the way. Well, once I got up out of the ravine and back onto the asphalt to walk to where the stream was, the spider webs, because nobody had walked or driven in that area, so, you know, the long strands that are stretched, all of a sudden it was lit up. And the Sasquatch began to speak to me, and they said, we are, you know, making them visible for you so you don't have a bad experience. So I'm about ready to cry here, because that was so precious what they did because of what happened with the giant spider beings. And so I was able to then just take those webs and move them. And so all along my path up to the water, every time there was a spider web that was crossed, they lit it up. So I got to see that beautiful magic, as well as that compassion that was just intense. And so they asked if they could show themselves, if it was okay, or if I would be frightened. And I was okay with it, but the council spoke, and they said, those who are guarding me, they said, it's probably a little bit too soon. We'll set something up at a later time. But please share information with her and talk to her about who you are as a race, as a group. And so it was that day while I was up there hiking and everything when they shared how they communicate collectively around the planet and how they link up. And so I became part of their linking up. And so I would ask a question, or the council would ask a question of the Sasquatch. And if the group that was right there with me didn't have the immediate answer, they would go down this collective line to get somebody who had firsthand knowledge. Mm-hmm. And so their belief in truth is very, very strong. And to me, that's the only way we can heal and recover and get through everything that we're going through, is if it's 100% truth. And that's part of what the council
100% true and delivered without agenda and from your heart,
Yeah, definitely.
Delivered with love and that purity, right?
Yes.
So I can see, you know, that's what I try to do, and on board with that. Yeah.
Yeah, and I find that to be a common theme, though, with some of the, like if you talk to Garrett Duncan talks about getting to purity, and so that theme is out there, and purity has to do with the words that, and we're surrounded by words, obviously. Any of us who have worked in an office environment or anything, everything's written, everything's out there. There's words on products we buy, all this stuff. Now I begin to understand the power of words, like truly understand that power. And we would do so much better as a planet to have less written stuff out there and more just pure heart communication and everything. So the Sasquatch have been there. They are a member. They hold seats on the council. I don't know how many, but it's not just one clan that's part of the council. I believe the council has potentially Sasquatch beings, not only from around our planet, but elsewhere, that are members of the council. The council spoke to some of them at one point in time and said that they that there were a group of Sasquatch that had their own ships and everything, and that they were going to bring them here to reunite with their family. And so I think there's a lot of, I think of Earth as, it has been like a prison planet in many ways.
I've heard that,
And so not that we're bad actors, but that's how the dark has kept us all, you know, enclosed here and kept us from being who we really are. My experience with the Sasquatch has just been, they're beautiful. They're just beautiful, powerful, magical. And I've only seen one, which I thought was phasing out. He ran across the road in California, and all I saw was brown and what appeared to be the image of a Sasquatch, and then gone invisible. So,
wow. I see Mr. Beans is.
Is he there?
Well, he's going to come on, I think, but.
Awesome.
He needs a big. Sorry, that's why I sounded so distracted there for a second. I was still listening to you. So what did they? Can you describe the, so you saw this fellow, like, clearly, right?
No, the one that was phasing out, what I saw was, like, the brown, which appeared to be the long hair throughout the whole body, and he was running across the road, and it was like that instant before he became invisible.
You never saw a face?
No face, no.
Yeah, you know, I've probably seen in maybe a dozen different ways. Mm-hmm. But he was kind of like almost to the totally cloaked stage, but not quite.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I've seen that. Yeah. Where is this guy? This guy is a real.
Oh, he's on there. Michael's on there. I see his name. I don't see his face. He was sitting down.
Yeah, I got to ask him something. Mr. Beans. Mr. Beans. What is up with this game? This is the kind of stupid stuff we normally do.
I don't even know, like, Michael's story or your story, but I'll have to do
something. Well, I'm sure we're going to be talking a lot more.
Yeah.
What is up with this guy? I forget him.
I saw him on the screen for a second.
I'm just going to call it the Bean Show from now on. I mean the Pork Show, sorry.
Hey, Michael.
So, can you tell me who's, do you know the names of, is the council with 12? Is it the council?
Oh gosh, no, this council, because it, okay, so it's called the Sacred Spiral. So I'll describe it to you. So if you think of Bruce Lipton's work and you think of the spiral and how he talks about the spiral, that if you're coming up the spiral, you are going to evolve or you're not going to evolve, right, as you're coming around the curve. And how they've described it is at the very top of the spiral are these super ancient beings that are from a different universe, and they seeded our universe. And so if how I think of those really top ones, I think of Mother, Father, God Almighty, because when their presence has been around me, it just floors you. You just, the energy, the love, the stuff they can do is just like amazing.
Well, just give me one second. Mr. Yeah. Beans.
Oh, there he is.
Mr. Beans.
Hello. Hello.
Nice to meet you. Thanks for showing up.
Is my mic on?
Yeah. Hey, if you want to try to post this to the Pork and Bean Show and some other shows, do it, because I couldn't do it. I tried and tried and tried. It's a technical difficulties. So do you want to try?
I looked at Pork and Beans and it wasn't running on there.
I can't get it on. I can't do it. I'm having technical difficulties. So do you want to try? Maybe it's just my computer.
Maybe I should go to Pork and Beans and see if it's running.
No, it's not. But well, you can try, but just try adding it and see.
Just try adding.
Well, you are adding it to all the other groups. You can add it to Pork and Beans too, can't you? I'm saying I tried to go live.
I could add the Zoom, but I can't add the. I can't make it go Facebook Live.
Why? Oh yeah, right. Oh yeah, you can't. Well, if I make you the host, you can. Can't I?
I don't know. I think you ought to just leave it like this. You ought to leave it like this and just put it up as a YouTube. Because how long have you been talking already?
Well, not that long, but this lady is amazing. We're going to have a full show where we have it going live. So we'll just have...
How long have you been talking? You've been talking 20 minutes already.
Oh, like since before 9 o'clock, and I was coming 5 to 9, I'm saying...
Okay, so it's been over an hour, right?
Yeah, but we're just getting into it.
Hi, Dawn.
Hi, Michael. How are you?
So you had a lot of Sasquatch fun things going on. Is that what it was?
No. Well, yeah, but she's... just listen in. We're talking about... she's an ambassador of the Sacred Spiral of Purity and Light Council.
Oh, there you go.
And
an ambassador of the Sacred...
Sacred Spiral of Purity and Light High Council.
Can you tell us?
Is that human or angelic or what is that?
That is everybody. That is, and I was just getting ready to describe it and everything. And
I interrupted you.
No, you're fine. I'm glad that you showed up. You're good.
You know what happened is last night. I was wakened early, like around 2 or 3 in the morning. And then I started doing meditation. I did like 3 hours of meditation last night.
Wow.
And I got pretty much blown out and revelations and all kinds of stuff happening. And then of course I was up at 7, and then had to do all my administration work running my groups and stuff. And then then I thought, oh, there's got to be around 11 o'clock on my side. So it was going to start at 12 o'clock. I noticed it was at 10 o'clock on my side. Oh, I'll just take a little nap. That's what happened. That's what happened. I apologize.
Well, no, we decided we're going to.
It was divine intervention.
We're going to have Dawn back for when we can go live or whatever, because great story.
So that's really cool. You're a galactic person.
Yes, yes. I have communicated with several different races, if that's what your definition means, yes.
So tell us about the council.
Yes, okay. So starting again, so if you think of Bruce Lipton's work and how he describes the spiral, as you're coming up the spiral, you're evolving. And so the very top of the spiral are these very ancient beings from a different universe that seeded our universe. And as you get down, you get the angelic people, you get the Elohim, you get Arcturians, the Sasquatch, you have all the Fae beings intermixed, you have the water beings, you have beings that came from the universe of the ancient ones. And so they're new to our universe. And then the piece where we, if you consider yourself a rainbow warrior, you have a seat on this council to vote. And so I'm the human ambassador. I'm the one who's here to talk about the council, because this council is loosely involved with all the other councils of light. And very, very intense, a lot, just to let you know, Mike, they are the council that's in charge of the what you would consider the galactic war, or the war against the dark. And so there's and that's why they're loosely involved with all the other councils of light, and those people sit and they vote, because I don't want to call it the war council, because it's beyond the war, because this is the council and all the committees that will be restoring planet Earth, and they will be restoring and cleaning the air, the water, bringing back even animals and species that have become extinct because of us, because of the way we've treated our planet. And so, and we're not talking about bringing dinosaurs back, we're talking about, you know, those that are within our sphere. And so the furthest out that they've talked about is maybe bringing back like the woolly mammoths or something along that line in a certain area of the planet, so that they could be a part of our landscape, basically. So
do you get the idea that this is like a Garden of Eden, kind of like it's just like the, like, you know, in a biblical sense, Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, it was perfect, pure, and everything. Is that what we're going to be returning to? Maybe not in a Christian sense, but that kind of place?
That's what the purity piece also, it, when you talk about the sacred spiral, has to do with where you're at in evolution.
Yeah, yes.
The purity piece has to do with truth and returning things back to purity. And so that would be making water pristine. So yeah, water is alive. We know water is alive. We know that, but the average person doesn't realize that water is alive. So it's making things the way they should be, but even better, because you won't have any dark influence. And so it's not necessarily about 1,000 years of peace. It's about forever peace for Earth. And so then their plans are they're going to march through our universe, and they're going to do the same thing with planet after planet. So people like us, if we want to, at that point in time when they're ready to leave Earth, we want to shed our human forms and join them, we can't. And so, like, I've already, my hand's been up since they started talking about that, because, you know, I was a huge fan of Stargate SG-1 and stuff, and I've always, like, even in my dreams, gone to different planets. And so that's, you know, what I'm looking forward to. And so I consider myself a member of the Rainbow Warriors. And so I represent Earth as one of those rainbow warriors. And so,
yeah, we're all driven to do our thing. Mike has this language lessons of the heart group that is, he's just reaching so many people and healing people or whatever. He's got his convictions. I've got my purpose, you know, and it's just like, really can't, you know, you're very driven. And I mean, you've got yours. It's just a beautiful thing. Yeah. So.
Yeah. In fact, not that I'll tell any details, but Barbara and I are starting something that's going to be taking off here pretty soon. We hope to have a launch in October. And so when that happens, we're going to be, you know, pulling in all of our friends and say, hey, you want to participate in this with us? And so.
Can you imagine your show with, well, you haven't seen us, you haven't watched one of our shows, but you better watch a full episode of the Pork and Bean Show before you commit to that, because we're pretty out there.
You know what? I think a lot of us,
like fun jokes.
A lot of us are like that. But, you know, I can be out there too. Yeah. I can be, I'm very analytical. Just so you know a little bit about my educational background, my undergraduate is hotel restaurant management. So there's that part of the hospitality, me, the caterer, and then law school is what I went to after I spent 7 years working in that industry. And so I have that analytical brain that wants to, you know, kind of take things down and analyze and stuff.
I think that's good, actually, because I'm kind of like that too, even though I'm very open-minded and heartfelt and whatever, but I think that that's important so that you don't start going off on, you know, taking things beyond your teaching, like putting your own
stuff
and everything on it. And then sometimes you get into a weird reality where you could even have like blood coming down your walls or something, you know, like just weird stuff. Mm-hmm. So I think it's very important to have that analytical mind in order to stay focused on, you know, what we're doing, right?
Absolutely.
That's great. You know, it's very interesting when I'm talking to people like you. Boy, that energy is really strong, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It is.
Really strong. Talking to people like you and others, you know, just the connection of experiences or whatever, and even from different sources, it all just ties together so perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It does. So
you were mentioning actually some of the members on that council. And did you say Thor?
Yes.
Because we have a friend. Well, he's kind of a nuisance, actually, but I guess we can call him a friend.
Nuisance.
He's a total nuisance, but we love him anyway. Because, I mean, that's kind of where we start as nuisances, and then we go downhill from there, right, Mr. Beans?
Yeah.
So
Peter Graham.
Yeah.
Yeah. Peter Graham. Okay.
Otherwise,
he had Thor come and visit him for 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Oh, fascinating.
Tell us about the members of the council that you know, and if you and a little bit about him if you want. So this is an introductory video. So we're gonna cut it off at 11 because you gotta go too, right?
Yeah.
But I do want to get into as much as we can, because and then, you know, like when we have the real video and when we reschedule you.
Right.
We can have people thinking about questions and stuff, and really make it really nice and interactive. And because you're fascinating, I love your story. So,
oh, thank you, I appreciate it.
You know why? Because I've got Sasquatch teachers and guides.
Yeah.
And when I am talking to somebody that really is on the ball, that they want me to listen to, something that truth.
Yeah.
They give me this energy, and I am practically just like.
Through the roof,
The energy is right through the roof.
I'm getting it on my side too,
yeah.
And I'm getting kind of the intuitive message that the Sasquatch that are with me are kind of like saying hi to the Sasquatch that are with you, like, hey, how are you? We're on this end over here, so.
Yeah, they're a good bunch, boy. They're the most loving. Yeah. They're so loving that I can be brought to tears instantly. Like, ooh, I've said that many times, but it's a very important point that. To illustrate how loving and pure and innocent they are too.
And yet they have that ancient wisdom too that is just amazing.
I mean, you know, I want to get more, we're going to get, I really want to get into your things, but just to point this out, yeah, they are, they're just, they're amazing. Yeah, they're all about love and no judgment. And because I've felt what it's like to reside in their energy. And I think that that is the energy of love and no judgment and heart space or whatever is where we are being guided to.
Absolutely.
That's what the Sasquatch people are here to reintroduce us to, because that really is who we are. And I'm sure that, you know, and they're working with you, and you've got other entities, or that kind of sounds disrespectful, but other beings working with you. So, and it's all, you know, a collaborative effort, at least on the light side, right? So
it is.
It's just a beautiful thing. So go ahead and tell us about Thor and some of these other guys or whatever. Yes.
Okay. So some of the key members that have spoken to me from the very beginning, so from 2016, Thor would be one of them, Valiant Thor from the Venusians, Baradiel, who is one of the archangels. What they told me is Baradiel's role, his official role, is to guard the Garden of Eden and the Tree of Life. And so when Baradiel speaks or he is present, his energy is, it's like an old grandfather, but yet he's young because he's not crickety. And like we get old and we get sore and our joints get sore, but Baradiel is, he's got that old grandfatherly like mentality. And then he's also
Mr. Beans.
Yeah.
Am I saying my name?
Go ahead. So he's a grandfather type, yeah?
Yeah, so that's Baradiel. And then the Archangel Michael, he was a very strong presence for the first 2 years, maybe 2.5 years. And then he comes and he goes. But at a certain point in time, which is written in my journal, so I don't have it memorized, he was going to go work with President Trump. And he was going to start to work with him. And so I believe our president, whether people liked him or didn't like him from his early times, that this council is trying to work things through him.
I mean, hey, look, he's, no matter what people say about him, he is different. And he's not going along with the, you know, what was happening before. He seems like something is guiding him, maybe whether he is aware of it or if he is whatever his intentions are, something, it seems like he's completely different, and it's at a time when things are changing. It's at a time of you know, people are talking about ascension or whatever, so it makes so much sense that they would be. And he really is like a totally different cat in there.
Yeah, he definitely is. And so so I kind of remained neutral there because I wasn't a fan of his before he got elected. And I was an independent as far as my political affiliation. Because when I was in law school, I actually did research for the Republican Party against the candidates on the other side. And when I saw what they did, when I didn't find negative information and they wanted to make up their own, it's like, hell no. If both sides do this, I'm becoming registered independent. And so I don't go down that political path.
Well, in the future, when we ascend or whatever, people's interpretation, whatever happens,
right.
I don't think we're going to be
purple people eaters.
Yeah.
You know? Or how about the itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot bikini? Remember that?
Purple people eater.
Yeah, that was from the same time. Anyway, I don't really, politics to me is like a bunch of kids playing in a sandbox. Like, except worse, because it can usually make up. I don't pay any attention to it because I know it's a broken, archaic system and it's not going to exist.
Yes, me too.
And, you know, it's going to be over with, and it's.
Yeah.
Because it's just, you know, it's not, it just can't, we can't have that kind of system in a new kind of reality or whatever, or our new beginning or whatever you want, because it's all based on judgment, exclusion, privilege, all the things that, you know, that are wrong.
Yeah. And
but that said, you know, I do believe that Trump or whoever could be.
I think the council.
I'm that energy. I mean, that, you know, even though it's going to be a broken system, there still has to be something, a catalyst.
Right. Start, right.
You know, and so in that way, right. That way, you know, you could be doing a damn good job.
Right, definitely.
And we've just lost half our viewers, by the way, or maybe more than half, but that's okay. Because
you got to let her talk a little bit so she can build up some momentum, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Go ahead, honey. Tell us about all the good guys that are helping out on, you know, making the Garden of Eden happen again.
All of the good guys. Okay, so some other names: Lanar. Lanar is one of the ancient beings.
Leonardo da Vinci.
No, Le. So L E. So capital L E, and then capital A N A R. Lanar.
Oh, that's like a female name.
No, that's like an ancient dragon name.
Oh, it's a dragon name. Okay, cool. So it's an actual dragon.
So he claims. So when I, like I told.
Mr.
Brian
B.
earlier
oh,
that
Mr. That, B. I mean oh, Mr. Pork, I'm sorry.
Mr. Pork, okay. What I told Mr. Pork earlier is that and see I just my train of thought just went boom, but
the name of the beast.
Yeah,
Lanar the dragon.
Yeah, Lanar is the dragon. He's one of the main dragons, and they come from a different universe. Now, they're very different. They're very intense. And what's cool is, like, if you've ever had a being, like, put his image in your face, when the dragons have put their face, their dragon head, like, in front of me, it's, like, it's massive. It's just like, and it's, they're very interesting. They are very funny. They love comedy. They love humor. But he's one of the top leaders. And so he's a very fascinating being. And then there's, the Anunnaki, there's different representatives from what the Sam race. So the Venusians, Valiant Thor is the main one that has spoken with me, but the others are some scientists and some different people that are part of what you would think of the Venusian group. So they have a group that is very science oriented on the council, and they may have others. It's just, that's the group from the Venusians that I'm familiar with. And they are very interested. And so when I, because I'm tied into the telepathic communication 24/7, when they're talking, a lot of times I'm just hearing it. I'm just a witness. And I say it a million times, I wish I had a recorder on my brain so that I could just push play and let people like yourselves listen to it so that you'd be like, wow, this is fascinating. Because I never took physics, and I don't have the super strong math background and stuff. And when they start like talking about different things and if this is possible or what if we do this or that, to me it's fascinating, but a lot of it just goes over my head. But somebody more sophisticated and knowledgeable in those areas would have a different understanding of what's being discussed.
Sometimes, like I said, I don't think the details are as important as annoying.
Right. Yeah. It's going on. And that's what I'm here to give, is that message, is this stuff's going on at a level that's amazing. They have a committee that is just there to feed the people on the planet when everything's said and done, and how they're going to reestablish zones where you can grow produce and stuff, so that it's, and there, the council isn't about like you have to be vegan or you have to be this. They're about organic. They're about you don't need to eat as much flesh as you have been eating as far as a species or a group. But they're about creating wholesome food. You know, I hear the stories about, oh, replicators are coming and this and that as far as food. I don't want my food from a replicator. I want my food to naturally come out of the ground or out of the water or something like that. And so there is a committee that is going to be working on agriculture and stuff like that. And there will be people like us, the Rainbow Warriors, that have expertise, say in agriculture, say you're a small farmer or you're a big farmer, you're going to be on that committee because that's where you naturally will gravitate towards if you're one of those people.
And you mean a committee that's going to be established after we get to
Yeah. They already have like the galactic members that are on the committee. It's when we become aware as a planet-wide, so-and-so's on this committee and that. They have a committee for basically mental health, for helping people work through things.
Well, Mr. Beans will be on that committee.
Yeah. It's very, very important because...
I'll be on the receiving end, hopefully.
Yeah.
Well, Mr. Beans will, but your counterpart, actually, will be one of the leaders and on the teaching part of it. But so go ahead. Yeah.
So there are all these different committees that are part of the council. And the way they kind of, what helps people understand is if you think of a piece of pie and you think of, okay, let's say Baradiel's the leader to feed the planet and he's at that point of the pie. All these people that are behind him in the piece of pie that's going to assist are no less important than he is. And in fact, at a certain point in time, they'll be able to rotate into that lead role. And so everything's about including, so it's inclusive. The getting down to purity, a good example that they talk about when they teach me about purity is that, let's say there is we could use the COVID thing as an example, the face mask wearing. How you would get to purity and the pure truth of the mask thing would be to go actually physically go all the way to the very beginning of when it was discussed and who discussed it, what agenda is behind it, what's going on. And then you could say, oh, this is bogus, or, oh, this piece is actually truth, so let's put it over here. And that's how they describe how we're going to be able to get to purity is we may not be running around reading people's minds at this point in time, and able to know bad actors and see things right away. We have always been reliant or dependent upon wanting people to be like we are. So if we're a person of truth and we tell pure truth, we right now don't have any way of knowing. When I say we, I'm talking about like the basic population of the planet. You don't know if you're talking to someone if they're actually telling you the truth. You have to go by your gut. You have to go by what you think. You understand? So
that's the old way, but I think right. With me, probably with you, mm-hmm. Albino down there, it's energy now. Energy is the universal language and whatever. And energy, like Mr. Peter Graham said the other day, and he corrected, and he was right. But I never did say it wasn't right, but... you can be communicated with energy and it could be a bad message or a negative message. But the thing of it is you can read the energy.
Right.
You can read the truth or whatever in it. So energy is a universal language for sure. So words and all that stuff is just words.
And right. And truth does have a unique energy signature.
Right.
Just like each one of our souls is like how they describe fingerprints. Each one of our souls has its own unique energy signature.
You feel that loving vibration when truth is being spoken. You get that loving, and you know, well, I'm getting it again. It's just an energy confirmation, or it's a knowing. It's hard to explain, but that's the one thing that can't lie. I think so.
Right.
I have two questions.
Yeah.
the first question is, did anything bad, did they talk about anything bad, like a sun flare or pole flip or anything bad like that going to happen in the future? That's the first question.
Okay. What they talked to me about is that the council has an event planned. It's going to be light. An event planned. It's going to have light, sound, vibration tied to it, but they have not told me it's a solar flare type thing that's going to wipe out the planet or anything like that. They said it's an orchestrated event. And I don't buy into, I guess, the mass death theory or the thing that's being spoken about out there, that just everything's going to be wiped out and all of a sudden we're a new Earth or something. I personally don't believe that. And I have not been told anything like that. I have been told that there will be a large percentage of death on the planet, but it's related to what the Cabal Illuminati have already put into play. And so it'd be deaths from cancer, deaths from disease, deaths from things they already put into play. And I don't know what that means, because when they tell me things, it's like I told Mr. Pork earlier today that they don't give me all of the facts because of the fact that I was attacked in the beginning, that it's possible that another being that could read my mind could read my mind and understand that I have actual, like, facts related to the war or what's going on.
I was just laughing at the name, Mr. Pork. I'm sorry. I love what you're saying. Go ahead. I didn't want people thinking I was laughing at you. I'm not.
No.
maybe Mr. Cunningham sounds better. Unless you're a Southern girl. Mr. Pork, sir. Whatever, the old Southern ladies said Mr. Brian or Mr.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway, go ahead.
So that I think if you're talking about what I think you're talking about, Michael, is that event doesn't seem 100% true to me. What they describe, what Corey Good or David Wilcock and them talk about, it doesn't seem 100% true to me. So that's my personal.
My second question.
Yeah.
Is you've been on this council for how long? Since 2018?
Well, 2016 is when all of a sudden it was April and May when the telepathy kicked in, the attacks and stuff. And so I've been with the group since 2016, knowingly with the group. Now they've shown me through walking through my life that they've always been there.
Yeah.
And those of us that are chosen, and when I say chosen, I don't mean like they lined us up against a bunch of other people to choose. What they told me is that they placed us in family pods. They placed us in work pods. They placed us in groups where they knew through orchestration on their end that we would eventually link up, because we each hold a piece of the puzzle. And so that resonates with me. That really resonates with me. And the people that I have met since all this stuff started, the council has sent me to specific conferences, told me who to meet, who to talk to, who to listen to. They've told me when, like if I've been listening to somebody speak and they're like, does that resonate with you? Does it seem truthful? And so they allow me to think so that I am coming to. So there's like two levels of me. There's the me that's still playing a bit of catch up and trying to understand everything. And then there's the me that has been downloaded all this information that's connected to them. So it's a bigger awareness. And getting into that bigger awareness is I have to be typically by myself, maybe have a little bit of, can I say any of that stuff on here? But anyway.
We pretty well ended and go, sure, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So yeah, if you need to edit it out, edit it out. But if I have a little bit of edibles, that will help me kind of reach that place. But certain, just having that peaceful setting, being in nature, and then I get to this awareness, and they have even shown how, you know, we all talk about we get downloads, and oh yeah, I know that they just download a bunch of information. That information is there, and they've shown me how it's there, that if the subject gets brought up, we become aware in a certain way, everything that they've taught us about that subject.
Well, the second part of my question was, since you've been there since 2016,
yeah.
Have they ever talked about me? Did they ever say anything about me?
No, but you know what? We just met.
What do you mean no?
No, everything I've heard about you is through Barbara Jean, and she loves you both. And so she hasn't told me even specific stuff.
She loves you more.
Yes. Loves you more?
She doesn't really like you that much, Mr. Beans, but she tolerates you.
Cut to the quick. Yeah. So Barbara likes you more, and the Galactic Council doesn't even know I'm on the radar.
I had a question though. What? The council, and you know, I'm not saying this condescendingly. I'm saying it with humor. But the council must be fans of Pork and Jesus, right?
That's what it is.
I actually believe that the council, specific members of the council, know exactly who you are. I just don't know who you are. And so they don't tell me people's personal stuff ahead of time or anything. Right. They'll ask me later. They'll say, what'd you think? Did you like them? What was the energy? They'll ask me stuff like that. But that's for me personally, for my growth. And it's not about, they're not going to tell me like your secrets or anything like that. They don't breach those types of things.
No, that's kind of.
You don't actually have a date for anything dramatic happening. Is it just going to be just an unfolding like it's been unfolding and like a wave after wave of progression?
We discussed that earlier, actually, when you were sleeping.
Why did you wait for me?
I don't know, but
Didn't you say that? I mean, I think that the dates, I mean, because we are creators, we're constantly creating our future, you know, as a collective and whatever. So dates to me are just like, okay, whatever. I don't put any stock into dates.
Yeah. They have channeled through me to another group that by the end of 2020, the main part of the war will be finished. They've already told me 2 years ago that they've won. And so they're masters of traveling the timeline. And when you have ancient beings that can be here in the past, here present, and then in the future, all at the same time, they're amazing.
You know what? I have to bring this point up because when you said that we already know that we've won, and the thing about time is, yes, they have done things, the Sasquatch with me have done things, I'll say this very briefly, but just to collaborate your point, they have shown me a glyph or something, which is their written communication 7 or 8 years ago, but looking back on it afterwards, knowing that they knew exactly that I was going to know what it meant 7 or 8 years in the future, and then look back for the conference. I mean, time and space do not exist for them.
Right. And they know.
So when they say we've already won, it because they're not working within the parameters of time. They already know.
They already know that we've won.
I just wanted to clarify that because, and I'm sorry, but when, you know, because people might interpret we've already won as if we've already won in our 3D reality of it.
Yeah,
but they're looking at it from the aspect of no time and space and all that.
Well, it's an event. It's an event. So in no time, in no space, they go from event, you know, like these things that happen, you know, every day is an event. And then, you know, but in that Trump getting elected or not getting elected, that's an event. So the events, they're not like in linear time, but they mark the shifts from one thing to another.
Yeah. Well,
they're very aware. And you got to think, this council is made up of so many different races and groups that you've got expertise in different areas. But they are very aware of, like when they talk to me about orchestration in our life, for all we know, your Sasquatch guides and family, the people that you're communicating with that you've grown to love, they knew way back when that they were going to be teaching you so that all this other stuff unfolds.
Yeah.
That's part of the orchestration, is to get us where we are. They have told me that those of us that are the chosen ones or whatever, I don't like that term because it kind of says some people aren't chosen, but those of us that are the leaders or the way showers, however you want to look at it that way, our lives were really orchestrated from the type of education that we had, the jobs that we got. So what they told me is that many of us, without even knowing, were witnesses with them sitting in our bodies, seeing through our eyes, hearing, seeing everything. They're witnessing a lot of the things that we personally experienced, because they knew it was like a moment in time or a time frame that was life-changing to us, or when we first discovered people are not honest. You know, it's like different times they witness that so they can remind you of that experience. So you're like, oh yeah, okay, I can see how that fits. And each of us has our personal life and our personal journey. And they told me that, like, I am Dawn first before I'm this soul that's inside of this body. I'm Dawn first, and what Dawn has lived and what Dawn has experienced in her life, that's who I am first. Second, I am this collective, this soul who has been incarnated and done different things. Then it's like when we get fully released, those of us who are the chosen ones, when we get fully released and our abilities come in, we're just going to be extreme powerhouses, and we'll be here healing people, working with people. And it'll be exciting. They've told me that we will be age regressed, that our body should live up to 200 years then. And they've told me all these different things, and I've heard it independently from other people saying they got similar messages. And that's how I put things together as far as me, you know, trying to make sense of everything.
I don't know if I can put up with 200 years of beans.
Well, speaking of beans, Mr. Pork, did you ask her previously before I awakened? Did you ask her previously about the question that I was thinking about last night?
I wasn't online last night. Am I supposed to be telepathic here?
Well, I just didn't know what came before me. The question was about adversity, about her adversities or her hardest times or her most.
Well, she had some trauma and stuff in her early days, but we, you know, she had the kind of adversity that you would expect. But you know, we can get into that on the
as long as that's covered, because that was a question that I had in my meditation.
You can listen back on the video.
And the second part of that question was, is there a connection between adversity and progress? Like, you know, you have a certain amount of adversity in this lifetime or another lifetime, and that opens you up on a psychic level, or that puts you in relationship with, let's say, narcissists or something, and then you have to work out on that level, or even puts you in a position to be one of those people who are, you know, in the pedophile victim kind of things.
Mm-hmm. With my personal life, so I grew up in Las Vegas. My father was very powerful in the state of Nevada, meaning he knew a lot of powerful people. But there were things that happened within our household, and things that I was told, like when I was in high school, about my father that made me want to research and find out more information about him, because I never understood his power. And he was so cruel, very mean drunk, very abusive, physically, emotionally, the whole nine yards. I witnessed a lot of that physical abuse done to like my siblings and my mother. Well, it turns out through the research and trying to figure out things about my father, is that he finally admitted to, which I had suspected, is that when he was a little boy, he was an altar boy in the Catholic Church, he was raped by the priest. And he was born late. His mother was like 50 when he was born. And so his father passed when he was 5. And so he started acting up. And so his mother put him in seminary school around middle school age. And he was raped and abused there even more. And so I believe, because he was a Korean War vet and doesn't talk about the war and stuff, that he was actually a super soldier in the Korean War, is what I believe. But I don't have any facts. I don't have any evidence or anything to that. It's just from living and being around him and everything. But he was a pedophile. I actually interviewed one of his victims in 1998, and spent many hours with her. He started grooming her when she was 11, and by the time she was 14, he was having full-on sexual relations with her. Well, I used to think my father was a demon, you know, as I got older, and I really, you know, looked at who he was and that he didn't know any of us on a personal level, and I always wanted to know what his motivation was behind his actions and the things that he did. And so, yeah, that's there, you know. It's a part of my life, but I've had super soldiers tell me, oh, you're one of us. You just haven't got your memories back. I'm not one of the super soldiers. I'm not against them or anything, but the council has told me by no means, you know, we have looked, you don't have any blank spots, you don't have any rewrite over your memories. So they can see all of that. They can look at us and they can say, oh, you've got some spots here where somebody or something has rewritten over your actual, what you experienced. And I don't have that. And
so, can I ask you one more thing?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm totally ignorant of it. What is a super soldier? I don't know. I don't know what they are.
Wow. My understanding is, and this is just going to come from those that I've spoken to, is that they, from the time they were little, were programmed and put through a program, whether it's Montauk or the MK Ultra type stuff, or they have actually been in one of like the super space programs, or they've been on the ground in our military and they have been mind controlled. So really it is mind control, but a super soldier also has been enhanced, is my understanding, whether it's access to your abilities or whether they inject, I don't know. You know,
like the Manchurian Candidate movie guy?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know the movie?
I don't know the movie really well enough to
it's about torture. You know, they take children and they torture them repeatedly and repeatedly until they break, and then they break again. And this opens up their mind to psychic abilities, but it also makes them black-hearted and ruthless and other things. Yeah. And that's what my whole meditation was last night, is this whole, you know, you can understand war on planet Earth, because there was a war in heaven, and what is denied in heaven is manifest on Earth. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there was a war in heaven, and that imprinted everybody with this war. And then that was before the angels came and the humans came, and now all the beings came, fell from heaven, was because of that war. Mm-hmm. And then that's why we have this theme of almost constant war on the planet. You know what I mean? It comes from that higher source down to the lower source.
I think I'm going to do a Fort Cunningham special edition and interview you just on that.
Meditation. Yeah.
Do that?
Who are you talking to?
Yeah, I'm talking to you.
Oh.
OK. we'll do a special edition.
I didn't mean to be interrupting you, but the thing about the torture of children is right on target for today's what's going on. The torture of children, where does it come from? What does it do? And the people who were tortured themselves by their parents for generations turn into the pedophiles and torturers and Satanists and Luciferians. And that's probably one of the biggest chunks of stuff that needs to get cleaned up.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you. I agree.
Look, like the Sasquatch have told me, whatever, one of their biggest messages is about boxes or whatever that we create of beliefs and perceptions and not believing anything outside of it or hating anything outside of it. And that's what we've been teaching our kids and our children through generation after generation after generation is, you know, they come into the world full of wonderment and talking to their ancestors and, you know, you see them looking up and all this magical stuff until we tell them that's all make-believe. It's the boogeyman in the closet. You can't like this person. We belong to this political party. You know, all this stuff, it takes their innocence away until we become more and more and more removed from what we really are.
Right.
And that's one thing that has to change. And I think that's speaks to the point we were just making, but yeah, it's
the message I got last night was when you give a child their innocence in their childhood, you allow that to develop.
Yes.
That's good. Mm-hmm. But when you take a child through whatever means and you take away their innocence and you destroy their childhood, that's evil. And to me that what this was coming from was like, in terms of humanity and our history, that is what good and evil is if you have a childhood that allows you to flourish, that is good. And if your childhood was, you know, abusive, neglectful, traumatic, you know, and you witnessed all these kind of bad things, then that was the effects of evil. That is what evil is. It's that, and that's what needs to be changed. And this is generational.
Yes,
and it goes back. Mm-hmm. It's also Luciferian, because when you attack the innocents, you know, that's the Lucifer kind of a thing. You attack the women and you attack the children. You attack the innocents. The pressure, the downward pressure on all women throughout the ages, you know, women didn't vote and they were oppressed and they were second class citizens. That oppression of the women was actually to get to the children so the children would suffer, you know. And then and then you have, like you're saying, your father's father was a maniac, you know, crazy man, you know, and so on. And
so, yeah, well, I mean, you're saying exactly what I'm saying, just with
And the Luciferian influence on the church is where the churches are destroying young men and young women's lives. That's where Luciferian evil got into the church. So this has been going on ever since there was a church.
Yeah, and that's exactly the message the Sasquatch people have been giving me. So it's a consistent message. So anyway, this is kind of just like a teaser video. This isn't even the official Pork and Bean show. We are going to have you back and like, you know, and like I said, hopefully this will inspire some questions with people. And then they can, and you know, we can get more live participation or whatever, because we really haven't even got we basically just, like I've literally said, with, you know, scratch the surface.
Literally scratch the surface.
But why don't you, in ending, you know, go give us something, you know, so like a cliffhanger, the end of season.
Oh, okay. End of season.
Look forward to your interview.
Yeah.
Which I really enjoyed having you.
What I would like to do when we meet back up for the live video is really answer as many questions as possible, and possibly even allow channeling to come through if the council has a special meeting or message. See, I'm getting tongue-tied there. When they're like thinking with me, I get really tongue-tied really easily. but it happens. But they would probably have specific messages to share with your listeners, with our fellow family here, because I believe your listeners are family. And so, you know, anything I can do that can help people, I would absolutely, you know, be overjoyed to talk about everything that I can.
Do they have any messages for Mr. Beans and I?
I personally want to know more about Michael's stuff and his meditation, because what's interesting, Michael, is that I personally, with my seer abilities and stuff, I have been going and I have been seeing these children and these people that have been underground for years and years, whether it was my dreams or actual visions. And now I feel their emotions, and it can be intense. And so have a problem, and that is one of the major problems on this planet that we need to fix, is stop that.
I had a little session. I had the part of the meditation, because my meditation went on for 3 hours. Normally I meditate for like, what, maybe 10 minutes or something, like a normal person. So this was crazy. You know what I mean?
That's awesome though.
Yeah, but it's heart-like meditation, which was given to me by a Sasquatch. But anyway, so I meditate, right? And then I started to review the pedophilia thing, right? And the way to do it is you go into your own pain. So your own pain is like the, you know, it's like the crystal ball.
Right.
So when you go into your own pain and you hold that, then through that you can see your mother, your father, your family, right? And you can, your mind goes quickly. So you can go out and encompass all of time and space. So I was feeling all the pain of all the pedophile victims and the pedophile, the perpetrators, and how they were a victim, and it goes on back, right? So I felt all that pain last night, and I contained it within me and owned it. So I owned all the pain of, well, it's not just pedophiles, but it's also of all abuse, all death, all illness, all that stuff. Every pain and suffering that is possible to feel on this planet by any being, as I owned it. Uh-huh. So, and then I embraced it. Then that's kind of like one of the things.
Oh.
Huh? Yeah, well, that's what they call in the Bhagavad Gita the beginning of consciousness.
Can I ask you a question? Mr. Beans.
Yes, ask away.
Because you know that I had something. Remember when I had that thing when I was like, I wasn't asleep, and I was like, I was seeing my pain, my judgment, all these things or whatever, but I was observing them, and I didn't take it on. I guess I could say I owned it, but I did the emotions and the way that it normally would make my vibration plummet or whatever, because those things are negative. I didn't take that part on. I just looked at it as an observer, right?
Yeah.
So was that kind of similar?
That's similar, but here's the way it goes. What you're doing is you are distancing yourself and
I know.
And then observing the pain, which is a really high thing to do, very high. And then you can take into account. But the way to actually you have to do it is you have to take your personal pain of your inner child, you know, your inner will, your deep feminine, your emotional body. You have to work through that until you end your actual personal pain. It's only when you can end your personal pain that you can see through your personal pain to connect it to your father, your mother, your grandparents, and all like that. If you don't end your personal pain, you know, you'll blow all your circuits out, because nobody can handle that kind of pain. As far as I know, there's only been a couple of people that have been written about in history who have to have reached the end of pain. Just like there's an end of fear, and there's an end of anger. You have to reach the end of pain.
So then
you can own your pain, and then inside your pain is all the pain that I described.
Yeah, but I obviously wasn't at that level. But how was I able to do that and observe that? Because that's exactly what it was.
It was a gift. That's actually a gift of wisdom.
Yeah.
It was a gift for you, and it's also a gift for you to tell us.
Yes, absolutely, positively. I don't know what Don thinks about that, but you know, for me personally, Don, I've had a lot of like stuff like that happen. Like one time is like, it's, this is possible. You could develop this, work on it. All kinds of different things. Like 3 months before my mother died, I had a past life regression thing with her.
Wow.
And it was like, whoa. It was like all at once. And it was like, I felt it all. And it was like, I knew what it was. And yet it was like so different. It was like, what? Whoa. But it was like one time. Right. So it's kind of like something for the future or whatever, you know, or whatever, something to develop or whatever. It's absolutely fascinating. But,
well, you brought up a good point, because like you're saying, this, the one of the issues that they've had on Earth for a long time is the angels.
Yeah.
And the ascended masters and the dragons and all the really high beings, the ancient ones that guard the light, and our upper archangels and the archangels, they can also see all the pain that there is, but it's not their pain and they can't own it. So they're looking at it as an observer. They're going, we're going to deal with this pain. Like, what's this about? And you know, but it has to be human. The humans who deal with their pain. And that's why so many people are doing shadow work, and they're trying to do child recovery, and they're trying to do all this kind of stuff, hypnotic regressions and stuff like that. They're trying to get to their core pain so that they can end it. You know, because you can look outside. You look out from the outside in, if you can see it, it's obviously everybody in the whole universe knows. Yeah.
I did it to you. I got you. Finally, I beat you to the punch.
You want to end it? Well, it's okay. Maybe we should end it.
She wants to end it.
But I was talking so much that I didn't give her a chance.
We'll go 5 minutes. We're going to give you 5 minutes, you guys.
5 more minutes. Okay. So, you know, what's interesting is when Mike actually listens to the part that you recorded earlier, you'll see that I talked about how the council has helped clear all of that stuff out of me and taken me back so that I can observe, like, the first time I became terrified of my father when I was a toddler.
Oh, so you're doing that now? Observing it without taking it on?
Yes. That's, wow. And so that's what they have done with me, is they helped me through that process to get through it.
Oh, yeah.
So that I could understand who I am and understand myself at a deeper level, because if I'm going to stand in this truth that I, you know, you're coming up against the world that really doesn't believe in telepathy or doesn't believe in all these different things, I have to come out there. And it's like Barbara and I talked about, she's like, look, you're going to have haters. You're going to have people who want to tear you down just because. And it's like, I'm okay. Bring it on.
Yes. You know, yeah. You know what I found when they've given me like no fear.
Mm-hmm.
When you have that knowing or whatever, that and whatever it is, it's no fear, and it's because we have to have no fear for what you know for, because you know we can't lose our way or our objective. We got to be
reality sure. Was before us.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who I was 4 years ago. Completely different person as far as awareness and knowledge, skill set, still was a good person. But I broke like that abusive cycle with my children. But I raised my children mostly as a single parent. And so, but I needed to understand where my father got his from. And he didn't get it from his father. He didn't get it from his mother. He got it from the Catholic priests. The people who abused him, and that's how he became a predator. And so, yes, that's there, but I don't want to focus on that. It's okay to talk about that and say, yeah, this is who I was, this is my background, but what I'm focusing on is the future. Where is this council taking the world? Where is this council taking humanity? And so that's where I'm at.
Yeah, and in closing, because We're gonna have a great live show, whatever. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put this video on and advertise.
Do you want to record some more?
I can't because I've got to get ready for work, and I've got to go to work.
Yeah, and I gotta go meet Sue at the border too.
Well, listen, but,
But no, we're going
to
do it.
I want to say okay, but then they keep it recording, and I'm going to then you can shift me over the power, and I'll try to see if we can get it going on. See if we can get it going live, just as a test, because might be something wrong with Facebook.
Yeah.
Okay.
I will have to like sign off myself just because it's 10 after right now.
I just wanted to say, so this is just a little precursor to the big show or whatever. So what we're going to do is, like, if people have questions or whatever, we'll do that. And Dawn, it was absolutely fascinating. And, I get confirmation energy from guests that they really, you're as legitimate as I felt. I wouldn't be just tingling all over with energy if what you were saying wasn't truth. So yeah, it's important. It's important stuff. I sincerely mean that. And this is, like I said, we'll have you back. We'll schedule you in the next couple of days, and we'll have you on for like the full, but make sure you have like 3 hours.
I will. Definitely. And let's see. So I'm speaking, I'm presenting at the Psychic Sasquatch Retreat this year.
Oh, and good.
So if anybody, you know, who listens to this preview wants to go there, that's my workshop, is all about the council.
I would like to go there, but I'm not allowed to go across the border.
Yeah.
So I'm so glad you showed up and you woke up on time. But to end it, I want you to go and ask the Galactic Council about me next time you talk to him. Okay.
I will.
You know why?
Thank you.
Because he's an ego based being. He's still on the lower.
I'm insecure.
He's a lower vibrational being. He's boiling at the bottom of the pot.
I don't see that, but I see that confirmations are so important to me, and having another person confirm something is always helpful. So I will ask them, Mike. I will ask him.
You know, I'm kind of like that too. And then I thought, you know what? If somebody wants to tell me something, then they'll say it. But whatever. But yeah. But
okay, push the button. Hey, yay!
Guys.
You didn't know. No. You lost, buddy. I did it before you. You lost.
I still see the recording.
I know it's recording. I'm telling everybody, the whole world, I beat you, Mr. Beans. Okay? Yeah, I know you're trying to. Bye, guys.
I want to try this thing of the sting here.
Can I leave the meeting?
Yeah, you can leave. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Have a beautiful day.
We're always going to be here when you want to come back.
Okay, thank you. Take care.
Bye. Chorus and beat so they can sing along. Timbaland knows the way to reach the top of the chart. Maybe if I work with him, I can perform.